Did you know that Big Bird once passed through the mountain village of Cloudcroft, New Mexico? No, not the Sesame Street character, but part of the legendary spy satellite. Hi, I'm Dave Dooling, Education Director at the New Mexico Museum of Space History, and welcome to another secret story from space. In 2012, I was looking for materials to use in spy camp. The government had just declassified a lot of material about early spy satellites, including an official history of the legendary Keyhole 9 Hexagon, also known as Big Bird. As I scanned the pages, I saw a familiar name, Cloudcroft. What did Cloudcroft, a mountain village 16 miles away from our museum, have to do with spy satellites? It starts with an Air Force observatory housing a 48-inch telescope outside of Cloudcroft. It was later handed off to NASA, sold as surplus, and now is being reinvented by a private foundation. But that's not the center of our story. Everyone going to the dome ignores this nondescript building along the driveway. Well, that's how espionage works best, nondescript. During the Cold War, and even now, we needed detailed pictures of the other guy's backyard, denied areas, as they are called in the business. Spy planes were risky, so even before we reached orbit in 1958, we were designing spy satellites. We started with the KH-1 Corona series and got bigger. At 10 feet wide and 60 feet long, KH-9 was one of the biggest satellites ever launched and earned its nickname from a reporter covering the first launch in 1971. It had stereo mapping cameras at mid-body. Capsules each returned about half a mile of film. Big Bird was launched by a Titan 3D or 34D. At the end of the mission, the now empty Big Bird fired its thruster one last time to drop it into deep ocean where no one could retrieve its secrets. But why did Big Bird visit Cloudcroft? I sifted through the pages. This popped up. The terrain mapping camera came here. Not the entire satellite. Imagine getting that monster trailer up here at all, let alone unnoticed. No, it was just the smaller terrain mapping camera, carried on 12 missions. It was built by iTech, shipped to Cloudcroft for celestial calibration, then off to Sunnyvale for assembly and launch. An important part of analyzing pictures of Earth is knowing which way you are pointed when you snap the shutter. That can affect your measurements of what is on the ground. The solution is to take pictures of the stars at the same time, as indicated by the little fan patterns. As the terrain mapping camera looked down, two smaller cameras took pictures of stars to the side, so you could calculate exactly which way you were pointed. The stellar mapping cameras were wrapped tight around the neck of the main lens assembly. But even with precision machining, small deviations were inevitable. You can live with them if you can measure them. But how? You send Big Bird to Cloudcroft to use the celestial calibration site. Here is a Google Earth view of the Cloudcroft area, and here is our nondescript building. Here's how it looks today. It's been abandoned for some time, quite possibly since the end of the Big Bird program. A no trespassing sign covers the faded official no photography warning. Place really needs a house and garden extreme makeover. So what went on inside? It was quite simple, but important. The camera assembly was trucked in, taken into a clean room, and elevated to the top. At night, the sliding roof moved back, and Big Bird enjoyed New Mexico's wonderful skies. Clear, stable, a great place to do world-class calibration work. To keep it nondescript, people working at the calibration facility were given instructions on what not to say. It was okay to be seen in Air Force uniforms, since Holloman Air Force Base is next door, and the Air Force owned the observatory. But no Army uniforms, because the role of the Topographic Command, the mapping agency, would give things away. And you do not mention iTech, known worldwide as a builder of aerial mapping cameras. It turns out we all got a look at this system in 1984 when it flew on Space Shuttle Challenger. STS-41G in October 1984 carried the large format camera and took more than 2,000 photographs of Earth. The camera now is on display at the Earth Remote Observations and Science Center in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. NASA's mission report describes the camera in great detail and shows it being tested at the Cloudcroft Celestial Calibration Facility. However, NASA identifies it as belonging to the National Ocean Service. The shuttle's LFC and the KH-9 terrain mapping camera were virtually one and the same. The diagrams and dimensions are identical, and they were all made by iTech. Okay, neat system. What did it see? We may never know. A lot has been declassified about the Keyhole series, but more remains secret. Most of the images from the terrain mapping camera have been released, but none of the stereo imagery. Remember that Big Bird was not the only spy satellite operating at the time. Its name and size overshadowed other satellites. Big Bird mapped the planet, but did not provide high-resolution imagery. That was done by the Gambit 3 system carried by KH-8. 20 Big Birds were orbited between 1971 and 1986. None failed, though the last was lost during launch. Meanwhile, 54 Gambit 3 satellites were flown for high-resolution imagery. Both were replaced by KH-11 and later systems. This is an example of what they saw. In 1968, NASA Administrator James Webb started talking about a massive rocket that the Soviets were building with the obvious intent of getting to the moon first. Some people thought he made it up to rebuild public support for Apollo. Photographs released after the USSR broke up confirmed that it was real. In the 1980s, the Department of Defense published Soviet Military Power. As many of us in the press suspected, its artwork was based on spy satellite imagery, such as this Typhoon-class ballistic missile submarine. And then there was the Caspian Sea Monster. This was a massive ground-effect aircraft that could fly a few feet above the water for up to 1,000 miles. The main antenna for the Soviet Deep Space Tracking Network illustrates one of the things you look for in spy pictures. The sizes of the cooling towers let you estimate how much power it uses. Infrared sensors tell you if they are in use. Here's a military airfield near Moscow with a large number of Tupolev 154 transports. Little things like oil stains on the tarmac and grass blown down by jet exhaust can tell you about traffic at the field. Film satellites are passé now, but New Mexico is still involved. Much of the data from modern spy satellites passes through a ground station outside Las Cruces. Similarities showed Hubble was based on KH-9 and possibly KH-11. The rate gyro assemblies that helped point Hubble were checked out by the 746 test squadron at Holloman Air Force Base before the last repair mission in 2009. Given that they are the center of excellence for this kind of work, it's my guess that gyro systems for spy satellites passed, unknown and anonymous, through Holloman on their way to space. Were they worth it? By striking a delicate balance of knowledge and uncertainty, spy satellites took the edge off the Cold War. It was not easy, and it was thanks to several thousand people who did their jobs very well and, for the most part, kept mum about the biggest space secret of the 20th century. When the KH-9 story was declassified and its veterans could at last meet openly and talk about what they had done, I sent a story to a friend whose father worked for one of the Big Bird companies. This was her reply. Thanks for watching, and stay tuned for more stories from space.